The name of the course is Organizational Behavior, and today we would be covering process theories of motivation. These are certain texts or reference books which may be referred for this particular topic. Stephen Robbins again, Introduction to OB by Moorhead and Littlefield. So we'll start off with the process theories. We would be covering basically three process theories today. The first one is expectancy theory, goal setting theory, and equity theory. We will start off with expectancy theory, which is Victor Noom's expectancy theory. This theory basically was given by Victor Noom, and the basic premise of expectancy theory is that motivation depends on how much we want something and how likely we think we will get it. As you can see here, motivation is fostered when the employee believes three things: that effort will result in performance, this is termed as expectancy; that performance will result in outcomes, this is instrumentality; and that the outcomes will be valuable, this is termed as balance. Victor Noom believed that basically expectancy is what goes, it's a cognition, or we can say it's a thought process, that motivation is not just need based, and it is a thought process and based on probabilities, how a person feels that his performance will lead to a given outcome. This can be explained with this diagram. Probability that effort is going to lead to performance is expectancy. The probability that performance would yield you the required rewards is instrumentality, and how far these rewards are valuable, that forms the total motivation. So the product of three of them, that is expectancy, instrumentality and balance, would yield motivation and would result into a good job performance. This can be explained with the help of an example. We say that, supposedly, there is a college graduate who is looking for a job, and he goes through an advertisement in the newspaper and finds three positions there. The first position is that of an executive vice president, wherein the salary package is around rupees 150,000 per month and requires certain years of experience, let's say 1 year or so. This is the experience required. The second job he scans through is that of a clerk. Now the salary given here is around rupees 5,000 per month, and the qualifications are very basic qualifications required to do this particular job. The third is that of management training. Now the management trainee, the salary given is rupees 15,000 per month, and no experience is required as such for this particular vacancy. Now this fresh management graduate decides, and you know how the process goes on, how he thinks over all these vacancies, that can be explained with the help of expectancy theory. The first one, where we say that expectancy is the probability that your effort is going to lead to performance. Second thing, instrumentality, probability that performance will give you the required outcome. And balance is the value of the outcome. With this given example, we can say effort leading to performance would be where this fresh graduate writes an application and it results in calls for interview. Second thing, instrumentality, where he takes the interview and gets the job offer. And the value of the outcome is obviously the salary part. Now let us see the first situation here when he thinks about being applying for executive vice president position. Now here, the probability goes in his mind and he believes that if he applies here, he would get a call for the interview. We would say that probability ranges from 0 to 1 in all situations. So here, when he believes that expectancy would be that he applies and he gets the call for interview would be 0. Because he believes that experience is required and he is a fresh management graduate, so he would not get this negotiation, he should not apply for this particular job. Instrumentality is because he would not get any interview call, so again it's 0. And the salary is very lucrative, very attractive. So, you know, obviously the probability is 1. It's just a thought process. Now, if we go for the basic formula of motivation by this theory, it says that motivation is a product of expectancy into instrumentality into balance. Here, it becomes 0. Because when you multiply these 3, it gives you 0. So, the graduate, the fresh management graduate is not motivated to apply for this particular job. Second situation is that of the clerk. The expectancy is 1 year that in case he applies, he would get a call for interview. Then he takes the interview, he is very much probable that he would get the job offer as well. And the salary is not at all lucrative, because he himself is an MBA and he would not be attracted by this salary. So it is 0. Again, the motivation is 0 here. The third situation, where that is a vacancy for management training. Here, he thinks that there is a probability that if he applies, he would get a call for interview. That is 1. Again, if he takes it, it is 1. He gets a job offer. And the value of outcome is quite attractive, it is 1. And so the motivation is 1 here. And so he would apply for this particular job, he is motivated. This is how the probabilities go in the mind of a person and then he gets motivated to perform. This we explain with the help of this example. Further, now values can be, it ranges from 0 to 1, but it should not be negative. So, what happens if either expectancy, instrumentality or balance is 0? We have seen with the help of the example that if either of them is 0, it gets 0. So, the person is not motivated to apply for the job and so he would not apply and he is not motivated. So, what are the managerial implications of this theory? A manager, that is what a manager can do or how he can apply this theory in practically in organizations. Firstly, he can determine the outcomes employees value. Say an employee is motivated by higher rewards in form of financial rewards, and the manager for his good performance gives him a house. Now that would not motivate him to perform better in future because it is not which he values, and he values the financial rewards here. So, determine the outcomes employees value. Second is identify good performance so appropriate behaviors can be rewarded. Make sure employees can achieve targeted performance levels. This can be used to find out whether employees have achieved their targets or not. Then link desired outcomes to targeted levels of performance. Make sure changes in outcomes are large enough to motivate high effort. So, once one outcome is satisfied, then another outcome can prove as a motivator and that can lead to a higher effort. Monitor the reward system for inequities. Basically, the focus is on outcomes, so the rewards have to be checked whether they are being valued by the employees or not, and whether they are fair or not for the employees. So that is the managerial implication of this expectancy theory. We will start with the second theory, that is given by Edwin Locke, and this is goal setting theory of motivation. As per this theory, motivation is fostered when employees are given challenging and specific goals rather than easy goals, abstract goals, or no goals at all. So this theory focuses that motivation is the outcome of goal setting. If a goal is given, a specific and a clear goal is being given to the employees, then they would be motivated to perform. So basically, difficult goals lead to higher performance. Specific difficult goals lead to higher performance for simple rather than complex tasks. And feedback enhances the effect of specific difficult goals. The first one, difficult goals lead to high performance. Easy goals produce low effort because the goal is too easy. Impossible goals ultimately lead to lower performance because people begin to experience failure. Specific and difficult goals, very clear cut goals, that is, it has to be given how much percentage has to be achieved instead of very vague goals. They would all also lead to higher performance. So, goal specificity pertains to quantifiability of a goal. Specific typical goals impair performance on noble, complex tasks when employees do not have clear strategies for solving these types of problems. And lastly, feedback enhances the effect of specific typical goals. So, goals and feedback should be used together. Feedback is very much essential, which motivates the employees and brings about a sense of improvement in his performance. Now, this theory is obviously backed up by a research which was conducted by Locke and Latham. This research was done on basically truck drivers at Weyerhaeuser in USA. Now, this was a company which used to load logs of wood from basically the forest to the godown, to the warehouse. And these set of researchers, they went in to study these truck drivers. And they could see that the truck drivers were not performing up to the level, the highest level of capacity. So, they tried to study these truck drivers and they saw that initially, when they started off with the research, when the goal was not given, the truck drivers were working at only 60% capacity. But then, after some time, when they learned that the goal should be given to them, they gave them a goal to achieve a 94% of capacity by loading a specific number of logs of wood daily. Now, when this goal was given to these truck drivers, they saw that gradually the efficiency increased. The capacity of working of these truck drivers increased. Basically, in a duration of around 9 to 10 months, they could see that there was an increase in the capacity from 60 to 90% and it saved around $250,000 to the company. Because now the truck drivers were loading more log of goods and the capacity enhanced. So in a duration of 7 years, they saw that around the efficiency was reached up to 94%. So we can clearly say with the help of this research that goals are very important for motivation of the employees. The employees will be motivated if the goals are given to them, clear set of goals are given to them. Now, this is again backed up by several researchers on these various types of employees, that is beaver trappers. Again, the theory was implemented over all these types of employees and it could be seen, the result was quite saying that the goals led to an increased performance and people were highly motivated. So it was down salespeople, engineers, assembly line workers, baggage handlers, college students, loggers, brain injury patients. So all these were the people on whom this theory was implemented, experimented, and then the results were achieved, which were quite phenomenal. So thus, we can say that the goals are stronger when feedback on progress is given. It's very important to give an immediate feedback on how the performance is going on. Goal commitment is fostered. That is, the focus of the employees towards goal has to be increased. That commitment should be there. And then adequate resources are to be provided. There should not be any lack of resources as such the basic requirements for doing a particular job. So those resources should be there in order to motivate the employees. What is the empirical status of this theory? The two key principles of goal setting theory have been supported. The first, research clearly shows that specific goals lead to greater motivation than do your best goals. It's not like that if you give a vague goal as compared to a very specific goal, the performance would be same. There would be a difference, certainly a difference. That is, if you give them a percentage that this percentage has to be achieved, the employees are going to be more motivated and the performance would be much more better. Research also shows that difficult goals lead to higher motivation than easier goals. Obviously, a challenging task would give a lot of motivation to the employees because that triggers, you know, that challenges their level of performance and their capability. So they would always try to prove up their level of capability. Thus, the difficult goals would lead to a high motivation. So where to set goals? The goals should be set at the maximum level that employees will accept and commit to. That is the summary of the theory. Then we go ahead with the third theory of process motivation, that is Adams' equity theory. Now this was given by Stacey Adams, and basically it is still being used into the compensation theory. Whenever in any organization the compensation structure is being decided, this theory is always kept principally in the mind of every person that the fairness has to be achieved while giving payments to the employees. So here, this theory believed people strive for fairness and justice in social exchanges. So whenever they work in organizations, they would always look for fairness and justice. Secondly, cognitive perception of fairness or lack of it affects behavior. Now this means, this is actually the crux of the theory, which says that whenever there is unfair treatment or unfair payment in the organization, people are going to get affected by it. And there would be anxiety or there would be a lot of tension in the mind of the person. And so, it's going to have a direct impact on the behavior of the employees. So, again, this theory again believes one more thing, that whenever there is an imbalance in the behavior of a person, he would always try come back to the level of equity, he would try to achieve it. And that is what, there are ways of doing it which employees generally take for. So, Adams' equity theory basically tries to say that the employees in the organization always compare their input to output ratios of self with the referent other. Now here it's mentioned on the slide what are the inputs and what are the outputs. We talk about the inputs, they are education, skills, training, effort, etc. And outputs in the form of pay, fringe benefits, security, recognition, etc. Now there are two parties with whom a person would always compare himself with, or the ratio of input outcome to inputs with that of other. This is the first situation, an equitable situation, where we see the person is actually comparing himself with the others and he is comparing the ratio of outcomes divided by inputs. We have seen in the last slide what are the outputs and what are the inputs. So a small example is here. That is, if the outcome is $2 per hour and the input is in the form of 1 hour of work, then the ratio is $2 per hour. Similarly, the other person with whom this person is comparing himself with, whom he believes that he is comparable with him, then you can see the outcome is $4 and the input is 2 hours, and so the ratio of outcome to input is $2 per hour. Thus, here we can see the person finds himself into an equitable position because the ratio is same. So now he is very much balanced and he would continue doing his work very peacefully. He is not at an inequitable position. There are two situations where a person would be in a very inequitable position. The first situation is negative inequity, where you can see here the person himself is actually comparing himself with the other and finds himself to be in a negative position. Now this is a situation, as you can see the balance here. The self ratio is, he is getting $2 for 1 hour, and so the ratio is $2 per hour. And the other person, he is working for the same amount of hours, 1 hour, and he is getting $3, and so the outcome is $3 per hour. Now you can see here, it's a negative inequity here, because he realizes that the other person in the organization, for the same amount of input, he is getting a higher output. So he feels injustice, he feels unfair, and he would try to actually come back to the position of equity by several ways. Now what are these ways? One thing is, he might work less, he might remain absent from the work, he might leave the job in the, you know, severe circumstances. So these are the ways by which he would try to balance himself. He might criticize others as well. So these are the ways by which he would try to achieve the balance of the position of equity here. The second inequitable position is positive inequity, where a person, when compares his ratio with others' ratio, finds himself in a better position, where he believes that his ratio is higher than that of the others' ratio. So here you can see the outcome is $3 for the level of input, that is 1 hour, and so the output is $3 per hour for himself. For the referent other, you can see it is, the outcome is $2 and input is 1 hour, and so it is $1 per hour. Here you can very well see that the position of this person is quite better than others. Now again, he is in a position of inequity and he would try to balance himself again. How he would do this is, he would always try to justify the higher ratio which he is receiving. He would always try to talk about the good things which he has been doing in the organization, the achievements, the success, and he would always talk about the hard work, the labor he has put in. So he would go around justifying his position and thus receiving or achieving the level of equity again. Now once this level of equity is achieved, the person feels very comfortable and continues with his work. So what are the lessons in the equity theory? The first thing is, pay attention to what employees perceive to be fair and equitable. For the managers, it's very important to see, that is, whether the employees are considering everything fair in the organization or not. Allow employees to have a voice, that is, if they feel there is some grievance or some issue, they should be heard well and then properly reacted upon. Thirdly, employees should have opportunity to appeal. If they feel there is something wrong in the organization, they should have the opportunity to go and to talk to the employers. Organizational changes, promoting cooperation, etc., can come easier with equitable outcomes. So if the outcomes are quite appealing and people perceive fairness in it, then obviously all these things can be done very easily. Organizational changes can be made because people would accept it and there would be more cooperation. Failure to achieve equity could be costly, but anyhow it has to be achieved in any organization in order to have a good climate of justice. Thank you.